must be lights burning brighter somewhere. Got to be birds flying higher in a sky more blue.
Good morning. Welcome to Right Thinking with Steve Coplon. I'm your host, Steve Coplon, and thank you for tuning in. Let's have a great day. Good morning, everybody. Glad to be with you. And happy 4th of July. Well, today is episode 229, Right Thinking with Steve Coplon. Is very pleased to announce that this week's show is called No More Robbing Peter to Pay Paul with guest Johnnie Lloyd. Tune in and hear Steve and Johnnie continue their series on right thinking, life, money, relationships. This week, they discuss the importance of cash flow, budgeting, and savings. Well, good morning, Johnnie. Thanks for being with me.
Good morning, Steve, and happy 4th of July. Today is a day that we celebrate freedom. However, we need to remember that freedom is not free, whether it be related to our finances, and that's what we're here today to help people gain an insight regarding to how do they gain freedom in that space, right?
I agree with you 100%. Well, you know, Johnnie, last week we were in our third episode in this series, and we're trying to sort of do a foundational building block approach here is, you know, why be concerned about money and start to see how money helps someone get their goals achieved. You know, how if you're on top of your money, they can help you reach what your goals are. But you got to know what your goals are. You know, you got to be focused on that. And then last week, though, we really introduced the importance of being able to see what you're spending and get it down on paper. And we did a thing that I call the budget game, a modified version of it, where we really tried to get into what spending looks like in a person's life. And we just sort of kept throwing it out there. And what I want to say today is that we are trying to take something that seems complex and make it simple. And through today's show, I just hope that people will catch on to it's not really this difficult. I mean, it may sound like we're going to teach you how to do budgets on paper and do different things. But no, what it really comes down to is knowing what you want out of life, get your priorities straight, eliminate distractions. And we're going to show some tools that I've developed over the years that you do your own versions of them. And that's what's so beautiful about us being together. So that if people buy in, so to speak, to, and it doesn't cost any money for this, it's a free service. If people buy in to what we're trying to give them, they're going to see some beautiful changes in their life as they can reduce stress and be well on their way to achieving some goals. So, Johnnie, last week we did what we call the budget game, and I asked you to think about some things that we might not have brought out that we spend money on. And I have one really, really large one that I'm just going to spit out there. And that is savings. And, you know, you talked about tithing was one of the last things that you got in. And I love what you said. Spending money isn't just on obligations. It's also spending money on things that you believe in. And that's about it. As close to what we're trying to do as anything that we've said so far. In other words, I'm trying to help people look at their lives and not be prisoners of their routine, not be prisoners of a lifestyle that they seem to be stuck in, to where they gave up a long time ago. And now a whole lot of people that will be listening to us, I believe that they're doing well, they're happy. They think they're happy, but yet if you really get down to a deep conversation, they have given up some of their dreams because they've accepted something early out that says, I'm just never going to be able to do that. I'm never going to be able to live that way. I'm never going to be able to be the kind of person that has extra money to give more to those that I want to. I can't increase my tithing. And I'm here to tell you that even if you feel that you're very stable on top of everything that you're doing in your life, and let me just paint the profile. Married couple, got some kids, they're all doing good. They're supporting their family beautifully. on for all practical purposes, they're doing very well. But it's because they accepted that they can't do more or other things. And then that, hey, you know what? I'm not trying to change them from being satisfied with what they have. But what I am trying to do is have them put a thought in their mind that says, I didn't have to give up on that desire, that dream, that goal, that thing that I wanted to be able to do in my life, to be the kind of person that has more giving to charitable things, more involvement in things. So many people don't realize that they can have more if they just got on top of what they have with a little more discipline and then a little more planning to be able to reach their goals. That's what we're trying to teach. And a little bit in today's show, I'm going to give a very personal example of something that's happened in my life. But Johnnie, what have you come up with that you might want to add to last week's conversation on some things that you might be spending money, cash out, things that you need money for?
Well, Steve, to be honest with you, I really like the end, what you were just referring to, about the things that we don't really think about, we don't include. Most people take their requirements, like we did Maslow's hierarchy of needs last time. So when we look at those things, people are easy to put down or think about the house, the car, things like that, but they won't do the insurance. They don't even do life insurance. They don't include those things. So when you look at your life, look at everything you need in your life. Look at everything. And then just take a moment, like you said, go into a room and just be still for a moment and see that. So then you'll see the charity pieces. You'll see the Girl Scout cookies. You'll see all the donations that you pop out. Because most people are using their debit cards, and it makes you, if you're not careful, it will make you or desensitize you to cash. Because the debit card is so easy, right? So it can desensitize you to cash. However, when you start tracking anything, then you become accountable for that you track. That you do not track, you're not aware of. You don't become as aware of. So one of the things I was writing down, and I love the direction we're going, is about your habits. Habits is something that you put on and you take off. So there's some habits that you're not even aware of. For an example, your children come in and they ask you for $20 for this for school, or, you know, you need to do this for school, or they're in college and you send them a stipend, or those little things that you don't even think of that eat up or start nibbling away at the resources you have. So those are the things I would add, the things that you don't even think about, the nails, the hair, the little things that you do that are not bad. You just need to account for them and put them in a way that you can, you know, that there's more than enough, because the key is actually having extra at the end. That's where we're getting them to, right? We're getting them to a space where there is, I call it, at the bottom line, there's a positive impact. And then you can make different choices once you see that bottom line.
Thank you. Thank you so much. So the big one that I put on the table is savings. And another use for savings, or another reason for it, is emergency funds, reserve fund, money that you've got if something happens that was totally unexpected. And in all my other courses and teachings, I really spend a lot of time on dealing with those suddenlies in life, things that you have no control over. And my whole premise of getting on top of your money is that's something that we do have control over, that a lot of people have given up that control and accept it less than what they should have in life. And again, I want to make a statement, because some people that sort of catch this too quick and don't want to go along with where we're going, they think that I'm not a proponent of living within your means. I am a total proponent of living within your means. But you have to be able to manage what it is that you want. And if you can take your living within your means and say, but you know what? There's things that I'm not able to spend money on that I would like to without going in debt. That's when you start getting tighter on not wasting what you do have and then redirecting it. And we're going to get deep into the substitution principle in a future lesson, future episode. But right now, I want to focus on savings and having that emergency fund, that reserve fund. And if you have savings proper, it will eventually go beyond savings and be able to go into your retirement fund. Funds for the rainy day goes far beyond just the rainy day. It goes into, as we get older and we're not going to be producing income anymore, we're going to need to have investments or we're going to be living in a scarcity mindset where we just learn to accept less. And there's a whole lot of complaining and grumbling and grousing with people that never seem to have what they want. And the one thought that you gave me when you talked about a higher level of having the extra, have you ever been with family members or close friends and maybe they all want to go out and get a bite to eat? And maybe it's your kids when they were younger, or maybe now, even adult children. When it comes time to picking up the check and you don't have a lot of money, maybe you do, maybe you don't. But the thing is, I've always felt that parents ought not spoil their children too much. Spoil your grandchildren for sure. But right now I've got children that have my grandchildren. And if we get together and we just decide to get together and go out and get a bite to eat, I would rather have some extra money to pick up the check that night, because I know that the budget for my children, even though they want to pick up the check or pay at least their share or whatever, could be spent on their children. In other words, if I don't cause, well, that's the example I'm giving. Go to a restaurant with your kids and your grandkids, and when it comes time to pick up the check, say it's a modest restaurant, it's a $12 a person that evening, and there are six of you, so it's like $75, maybe $80 counting the tip. Or even it's something like an ice cream where you're spending $4 or $5 a person, so the total is going to be $23. Well, you know what? Being able to pay for a couple other people and know that because they didn't have to spend that money, their budget's going to go better next week. That's all. And so that's a real wonderful feeling of success for me, is to know that I can take my kids out to dinner. I can pick up the tab for a friend. And I'm not saying I do it all the time and I'm spoiling people, but I'm saying that it's a freedom that I want to have, to not feel like, well, I wish I could pick up the check, but I can't. But if your money's that tight. So that's the only point I want to say. But with savings, here's the personal lesson that I said I wanted to give. When I was a kid, I knew that I was going to be in business. I set my mind at being an accountant very early in my childhood. And then as I got into college, but I had a desire to travel and do things and not be so settled down yet. And I started spending a lot of money on travel and not working. And my father, he used to try to get me to settle down a little bit and say, you really ought to start saving. And my answer to him at the time, because I was pretty smart in my own mind, of course, I said, well, that's okay, Dad. You know, I got all the money I need right now. I can afford to do what I'm doing. I'm not using debt or credit spending. He goes, I know that, Steve, but you really need to start putting some aside in case something happens that causes you a financial problem and you don't have any savings. It might be difficult for you. Well, I've been plagued in my life with a whole lot of health issues. And so when you're cruising along without savings and all of a sudden something happens and you don't have money for those doctor bills or for that emergency, you're out of work for for a couple months because of a surgery or something, when you've got downtime, it's very, very hard to get back on your feet. And I spent a lot of time in my younger years sleeping on my mother's couch when I had a surgery, or I had a bedroom that my brother would let me use his bedroom, and I already moved out. But my point is, we don't want to be destitute. We don't want to have to be so much always depending on others to take care of us. We want to be in a position where we can take care of ourselves and take care of others. And what I want to say this is, if you're ever down, like I just described, and that's just the tip of the iceberg that I described for myself, if you're ever down like that, it's okay to let people help you. And just remember, as you heal, put a desire in your heart to do for others, because others have taken care of you as well. And that costs money sometimes. So what I want to get at now, though, is savings. I just want to give you a hypothetical. Take a 41, 42-year-old married couple with kids that are, a young age, maybe elementary school, junior high school age. And I try to encourage them to start saving more. But what they say, and they make a very conscious decision, a choice, is we're not worried about saving. We both got very, very stable jobs. We're spending a lot of money on entertainment, doing different things, but no savings. They're living a very, very affluent lifestyle, very social life. A lot of expensive concerts, a lot of expensive restaurants, a lot of expensive vacations. And they're living right on the edge with no savings. And when I talk with them, I said it's hypothetical, but I know hundreds and hundreds of people that have this mindset. When I talk with them, they justify, hey, Steve, thanks for trying to focus me, but we're not worried about it right now. I've been at the same job for 7 years. My wife's been working her job for 6 years. Everything looks good. We can afford what we're doing. We're not going in debt right now. And my answer is, you might not be going in debt, but if something happens that's a major change in your life, that's something out of your control, job layoff, your employer goes under for some reason, the pandemic comes and causes the employer to shut you down, and the unemployment that you get is not enough to keep your lifestyle, and then all of a sudden, you don't have enough money to do most of the things that you're used to doing, not just the extras, but even the basics. And it could mean downsizing your lifestyle. It could mean living in a less expensive place where you live. So my point is, don't put off the commitment to start saving so that if something unexpected happens, you will be able to weather the storm and get through. You just call that the emergency fund, the reserve fund, but that even might run out if you don't have enough set aside. So just be disciplined. What's your thoughts on that conversation, Johnnie?
Several things, actually. One is we have learned so much through what we have, at least I believe, most people have learned a lot through the pandemic. Instead of calling it a pandemic, I like to call it a crisis. So there's a lot of things that will happen in our lives that we can look at as a crisis. And part of what the emergency fund is for those times. Let's say it's not even negative. Let's say that you have a call to do something and you want to go back to school. Or you have a call to do something and you desire for your wife, y'all just had a child, and you want her to stay at home, or she needs to stay at home, or he needs to stay at home for a moment. You have that there. And so you don't end up in places that will cause you stress, strain, or struggle, right? And it doesn't mean, like Steve already mentioned, that you may not have to downsize or some things like that. However, the opportunity is for you to make that decision. However, if you don't have the emergency fund, if you don't have a savings account, then all of your options become graced options with someone else. And yes, we do have great family that will take us in and help us and all of that. I understand that. However, when we first started off, we talked about how finances can impact your stress level and how your stress level can impact your health. However, I'm going to take it a step up and I'm going to say that not just your health, but it can impact your relationships. Every relationship in your life, it can impact your relationship with your children, with your spouse, because one of the top three things that people end up in a divorce or a negative situation in their marriage or relationships is connected to money. So by picking up these strategies and applying them to your life, and not just that, applying them or teaching them to children, whether they be teens or tweens, you can teach the same concept to them so that they learn it so early on that it becomes a habit that is in their subconscious mind that moves forward. So that's the way I'm looking at it. It is about, we always looking for a way to leave a legacy. We're always looking for a way to impact other people. Let's do it in our household. Let's have some self-control in our household. Let's move forward in our household so that we do have a savings and all of that. So I know people, Steve, that are in the category that you just mentioned, like 41 or 50-ish. And during the pandemic, there are some people that were working and never stopped the beat. I mean, nothing ever changed for them. They just moved home and started working from home. So their employer is, whether it be federal, state agency, whatever, they didn't have to worry about that. Then I have people in the same age group that literally they had businesses and they were doing amazing and everything disrupted and it was abrupt. And so what happened for them in some cases is they didn't have an emergency fund. They didn't have this other pot of money that they could go through until some other changes happened. And then they ended up losing a lot of things that they had worked for. So that's the part. The part is the best time to make a shift in our life or to get a new habit or to structure our life more advantageously for our future is when we don't need to. So that's the best time. When you're hungry, that is not the time to go into this grocery store and buy food. I mean, let's just honestly. So when you have a need financially, that is not the best time to start looking and say, okay, let me budget now. Let's budget now. Let's learn those habits so that when you need that, when you need that skill set, and that's what a habit is. Habit is a skill set. So I don't care where you've come from or what your background is, you can learn this skill set. And so that's what we're doing. We're giving you information to increase your skill set because they're not teaching a lot of this in school. They're not teaching a lot of it, you know, in families. So change. When you change your habits, you change your life. When you change your mind, you impact your world. And that's what we're doing. We're giving you information that will impact your world.
Oh, Johnnie, I love being with you today. Now, about 5-6 years ago, I taught a couple days a week at a high school. I mentioned it before, the Achievable Dream Academy in Newport News. And I taught the students everything that we're talking about now as to how to think about money. I mean, that's where I developed the topic paper so these students could start thinking about what their goals in life are, what's a good life, what's a better life, and stuff like that. What's the importance of savings? And when I taught them how to do the cash flow budget, when I taught them to do the basic process of write down everything that you spend and don't worry about what day of the month you spend it on or what time of the year. And we're going to be doing that worksheet in a future lesson, but I identified cash in sources that, you know, you identify everything that money comes in. In other words, cash flow is all about in and out, money coming in, money going out, the flow in and out, the flow in and out. And so I broke it down and we're not going to get into these sheets today, but I do have these sheets. Anybody that wants them, that wants to get ahead of ourselves here, just rightthink.org. I'll give you the sheets. But what it is there's one sheet that you just write down everything that you know is going to be coming in. It could be a tax refund that you're expecting in April. So write down if you file your tax return early, you might get it in March. If you don't file it until April the 15th, you won't put it into your budget until sometime maybe in May. But the point is, we're identifying things when they happen. That's what we're going to be getting into today. But to finish up, because it's going to be a good segue, when you identify all the cash in and all the cash outs, there's a series of cash outs that don't happen on what I call a regular basis. They're like one-time things, like a once-a-year car insurance or twice-a-year car insurance or whatever. The birthdays for most people I know only have one birthday for themselves each year, but you might have 10 people that you celebrate. So these are things that don't happen on a regular basis. So I've got sheets that will help you focus on all that. But when I was teaching to these kids at Achievable Dream, at the very end of the class one day, a student that was doing really good, one of my best students, raised her hand and said, "Where do you put savings on the cash out sheet?" Because what confused that student was that it wasn't someone as a vendor. It wasn't an obligation to someone else. And they didn't. In other words, we're talking about, what are your obligations? What are the things that you have to do? And so the question came up, what do you do? How do you show savings on it? And the reason is, it's not really a cash out to, if the money's in your bank account and you want to have a budget item for savings, it doesn't go out of your bank account in the student's mind. And so I dug this up right before we got on the air today. And this is a letter that I wrote to the teacher to pass out to all the students. And then I went over it the next class. And here's what it is. "Please apologize to the students for me that I did not properly answer the question about how to list savings on the sheets. It is to be listed like any other cash out that will pay to any other obligation, such as rent, utilities, groceries, gas, etc. The difference is that you pay it to yourself. Once you put it on the sheet to be a cash out, it needs to be physically transferred to a safe place. Well, it will not be used for something else. This could be into a savings account in a bank using online banking. That is probably the best way to do it. Another way to take the cash, put it into a piggy bank. A piggy bank could be an envelope that is kept in a very secure place where it not will not be touched. Ultimately, the money is best put into a savings account in a bank. Eventually, it can be transferred into other types of savings or investment accounts. You must start small and grow big. You cannot generally invest the money until the amount is a little larger than the small savings amounts that are in the early days of the beginning to budget process. The great thing about starting to save by putting yourself into the budget is that it doesn't take very long to see the savings amounts grow, and then you will get to a place where you realize that you would rather save for something that is one of your goals than spend it on things that are not important, but merely wasteful or totally unnecessary, that would not have made any difference to you had you not done it in the first place. After a while, you will get a satisfaction that you have achieved something good, and your discipline will become stronger and stronger. If you do this while you are relatively young, you will get ahead in life and be able to do things that will amaze you. You will be one of those people that you meet from time to time that you admire greatly because they've done something with their lives, like buy their first house at 25 years old because they saved the down payment and built good credit early in life. It is endless what you can do once you put your mind to it and stay focused. Always remember that pennies add up to nickels. Nickels add up to dimes. Dimes add up to quarters. Quarters add up to half dollars. Half dollars add up to dollars, and so on. A journey of 1,000 miles begins with a single step. The quotation is from chapter 64 of the Tao Te Ching by Lao Tzu. I wrote that to the teacher to give to the students, and it connected with those students. Now, Johnnie, I haven't remembered that I did that. I pulled it out. I wrote that over 5 years ago, May the 5th of 2016. But savings will get you established. It will get you started. It will give you opportunities. It will give you choices. It will open up multiple options for you in your life.
Absolutely, Steve. And it's interesting because what I'm hearing about that, number one, is really powerful to go in and help children to transform their thought process. And the question that she asked was really extremely, extremely powerful, because just like with our time, we don't include ourselves in most cases. With our money, we don't do that either. So when we don't do that, when we don't include giving ourselves, including ourselves and giving an investment, whether it be savings or whatever as well, then what happens is we miss this huge gap and people want to know why their budget doesn't match up. It's because we're doing it, we're just not including it. So then when you go and you purchase a house or whatever, they consider 100%. They look at the large picture. They're not giving you 10% for your tithe and offering or your giving to things that you believe in. They're not subtracting, you know, the 10% that you're investing or putting in yourself. So we have to consider that. So that's why it is so important to know how much you have available to spend so that you don't end up being house rich but life poor. And the other thing that I love about it is, this is what I've learned when I've done financial literacy, when I teach it, is that when the children are in the room, the children become an accountability partner for the parents. I'm going to repeat that. When the children are in the room, the children become accountability partner for the parents. And in so many cases, especially now, our children are so attached to sometimes social media, and we are too. So the deal with that is, can you imagine setting up and giving your child a job or saying, what do you want to be, and helping them start a business? I'm putting quotes around that, and then start teaching them what that means about good work ethic and all of that. And then you have to set aside money. Do you know how much further they'll be in their life by knowing that? Steve mentioned that. That changes everything. That makes your child a champion in the arena for finances. That helps them understand that they have resources that coming in. And I did this with my daughter, and I'm a backup that's probably going to tell you my age. When I was growing up, my parents did this thing called a Christmas fund at the bank, where you put a certain amount of money in, because you did, it wasn't, they didn't call it a budget, but you put a certain amount of money in every month to get to this certain amount of money that you wanted to spend for Christmas. Do that. We didn't include that. You don't put Christmas on your plan, but you do spend the money. So you need to do that. So do the things that you know, not just for the gifts that you're going to do. Consider the holidays. I mean, major holidays like Christmas, because you're going to do some things. And then when you set it up, then help your children learn the habit by saying, this is how much money I have accounted for you for Christmas, right? And they get a chance to spend it the way they want. I'm not going to deal with Santa Claus. When they get older, they know that you're buying the items. Let me go like that. They know that you're purchasing the items. So don't let the children put the pressure on the parent about what they want. Give them accountability and responsibility dually on both sides. But going back to what I was saying about some of the classes, what happened is I had one of the students, the mother came back in and she said, she's wearing me out. And I said, what are you talking about? She said, I have to cook now. And I said, huh? She said, we go back. She said, you can't go to McDonald's. That's not in our plan. That's not on the line. She said but how I did it was I gave them a vision board, and we've talked about this a little bit, but they were making an account, not just for savings, not just for getting out of debt, not for that, but they had what we call a vacation account. And so if they had a certain amount of money, they could go to Disney. And she knew every time they decreased and didn't do what they said they were going to do on those lines, what would impact is those lines for her vacation to go to Disney. So what she did is she held her mother accountable. She said, we're going to Disney. we're doing this. We're doing that. So get everybody in your home. After you set up your budget, get everybody in your home engaged. Because if you're the only one that's trying to do it, you look like the bad guy. And people don't want to look like the bad guy. Be the good guy or good girl or whatever you want to call it. And bring the family together, because a house divided against itself won't stand. And it won't stand as it relates to this plan, this cash flow budget, and building a savings account. People don't bring everybody together on one accord. And when you do that, then you end up holding each other accountable. Now, that doesn't mean that you can never go to McDonald's, and I'm using McDonald's, but, you know, in going out and eating or whatever, because Steve has alluded to that. However, it does give you an opportunity to know the impact of that decision, because sometimes we don't feel like we're empowered as it relates to our finances. We are. It's about shifting our mindset and saying, I am accountable and I am responsible. You know, so then you don't look at your employer and say, well, you know, my children need braces, so I need a raise. You know what you say? You look and you say, okay, how are we going to do this? How can we do this? And then you readjust so that you can do it. Now, I'm not telling you not to work hard and your through your work ethic and your impact to an organization. They're not going to give you a raise. I'm not saying that, because they do. However, this is what I'm going to tap into, and I know it's probably stepping above Stephen, is when you get a raise, what are you doing with it? What decisions are you making with it? Because you have more money coming in, right? Is it just melting in your budget? Is it just melting away, and before you know it, you don't even know it came? So it's about being accountable and responsible. Okay, so I'm just saying, look at that. Look at the whole picture and then take control. Don't blame others. Don't shame yourself. Reclaim your power as it relates to your finances and your time by tracking it, by making decisions, by building habits. You go to the gym to be strong, you have to lift weights. Somebody else can't lift your weights and you get the muscles. That's not the way that works. You have to lift your own weights to get those muscles and the benefit of that, right? The same thing we're talking about today is you have to lift your own weights to get these muscles. But in the end, you bad. You know it, and you can proudly walk it out, because now you can do things. You can you can do the things that you've always enjoyed. You get a chance to make the choice, and that's what we want for you. We want you to be in a place where you're making the choice, and that's what the key thing is about this. So, Steve.
Wow. Johnnie, I said early out in a couple of the beginning episodes, what a joy it is for me to have you share this conversation with me, make it a conversation and not just me doing a presentation, because great minds think alike. Not me, my wife, Donna. She's been listening to our shows and encouraging so many people to start listening to it, because it will help people get started and it will help them tune in. And my wife's a believer in, you know, what we're really teaching is to take knowledge and information and facts and get into a certain level of detail, so that we don't just sort of a whim and a prayer, so to speak. You know, like, things don't go away on their own sometimes. And so, you know, but you have to be honest with yourself, and you have to stay focused, and then you have to monitor what you're doing, and you have to stay on top of it. But if it becomes a habit to where it's just the way you think, it'll happen automatically after you get good at it. And, you know, I've been doing this for a long time. But the one thing that Donna said that I wanted to point out when I said great minds think alike, Johnnie, the main thing that she wanted to make sure that I brought into the conversation, you just did. And she said that any family budget must be done with both spouses working together and holding each other accountable. And sadly enough, last week, you know, I talked about divorce being one of the, you know, you don't want to get into the expenses related to divorce. Lawyers will drain you. They got kids they put to college because we pay them too, you know. But the thing is, I always joke with my lawyers, hey, you know, like, how are your kids doing? They're all going to college, you know. I say, well, make sure they send me a thank you note because I paid for their college education, all the bills I had to spend, you know, in business things that I do. But here's one that I want to put back on the list that's memberships, when you buy health club memberships and things. And that's very important because that's, you know, you want to be able to do that. You might be able to find alternative natural ways to eliminate that expense. Like I go to the beach, but I have a gas bill because of that. And I calculate it all the time. My gas bill, it's a gallon each way. And I go 5 days a week from June to November with several, you know, some days I can't go. But I justify that I spend $700 or $800 on gas just going back and forth to the beach because I don't pay rent to be down there in my office on the beach. It's the most healthy thing in my life because it's my health club membership. It unwinds my mind a lot, you know. But appliances, you know, people don't put in their budget very often appliances. When they break down, that could be anywhere between $400 to $2,500 for a big refrigerator or freezer or something. And that hits you bad. People just don't generally put appliances into their budget. Take an inventory of how old your appliances are. Do you think they're going to break down? And maybe start putting a little item in there for breakdowns of some appliances. Roof repairs are going to happen to you. We didn't go into household expenses. We could do that for the whole show, but we're not. But the other thing, though, is that you don't want to be caught off guard with the car repair and things like that. Now, since most people don't put it into their monthly budget, they need credit when it happens, or they need a reserve fund. They need to have a couple $1,000 off on the side so that if they do have a car repair, they get their car fixed without having to go heavy in debt on it, and they don't lose their job because their car broke down. They couldn't get to work. So what I really want to talk about right now, though, is to say that a little bit of savings goes a long way. And when I was a paper boy, I owe so much of my success in life to what I learned as a paper boy, but I saved $5 a week. And that doesn't seem like a lot, but I was only making $10 or $11 a week when I was 13, 14, 15 years old. But I started when I was 14, 15, 16. I had it for those 3 years. I bought my first car at that $5 a week, my first year. I saved $250 the first 50 weeks. It was just forced savings. When I got my money from the paper company, I had this investment program with them, a savings program that was very easy to do. And so my first car was a 1959 Ford, and I got it for $250. And so I bought my first car with a year's worth of savings. That's just a good example. Now, I want to get into the way money comes in and out, because we're also going to talk about cash flow budgeting, not just savings today. And we've got right at about 15 minutes, maybe 12 minutes, okay? But it won't take that long to make the point. When people do a monthly budget, we're going to talk about the difference between just looking at it like in the big picture, this is how much I make a month, this is what my monthly expenses are, so I'm going to be okay to spend this money. Well, the problem with thinking like that is that's the big picture, but the timing may not work out for you. And I came up with a very, very simple illustration that is the basics for what we're going to be teaching over the next couple of weeks or so. And I use this method whenever I've got a lot of stuff coming up. I go back to the computer and I do it all in a day or so. And I look at everything coming up for the next couple of weeks, couple months, on a weekly basis, and I look at how my money comes in. And so the basic idea, and I've got worksheets that can help you do this if you want to contact me, but you don't need my worksheet. It'll help you. Just go across the columns in a on a piece of paper. You can do it yourself or you can do it like in Excel. Each column is a week, week one, week two, week three, however far you go. And you put the dates in from January the 1st to January the 7th, from January the 8th to January the 14th, et cetera. And so you build this weekly table. And then over in the first column, you put all the money that's coming in and you identify the source of the money and the dates that it's going to come in. It may be a paycheck. And if you get paid every 2 weeks, you go into there and you put what your paycheck, net paycheck is going to be. And you go to the week that you've spread across the top and you put the amount of each paycheck in so that if you did this for 3 months and you're getting paid every 2 weeks, you're going to have probably 6 or 7 paychecks. So you can look at the sheet and just pop in where that money is. So now you're creating like a visual diagram of where your money is. So your paycheck might be, in the example that I'm giving you, this is a 4-week example. Follow me now. In week one, you're making a net of $425 a week. So you just go week one, week two, week three, week four, and just plug in 425, 425, 425, 425, and then do a total, which is $1,700. Now, most people just say, well, I'm going to be making $1,700 this month. No, you're making $425 net a week in this example. And it's critical that I break it down into the weeks. And here's why. You're a young person, you're living at home with your family, and you want your own apartment. And the rent for the apartment that you want to move into is going to be $800 a month. And it's $100 a month of utilities also. And you want to start being able to take care of your own expenses for food instead of eating out of the refrigerator at your mom and your daddy's house. They're a little tired of it. They're starting to ask you for a little bit of reimbursement, maybe family budget money. You're going to be living here, you put throw a little bit into the kitty. Well, let's just give you a budget of $75. Hey, I'm not going to be giving you 1,000 numbers here. I'm only giving you 4 numbers. Your income is $425 a week. Your monthly expenses, just to keep it really simple, are only 3 things: rent, utilities, and food. Your budget is $75 a week for food, $300 a month. Your rent is $800. Your utilities are $100. Your total expenses are only $1,200 a month. Hey, I'm a total success. I just told you that I'm making a $1,700 a month, $425 a week. So I've got $500 better than what I need. So I'm ready to move out. So you start looking for an apartment. You start letting your parents know, I'm getting out of here. Well, you're ready to move into an apartment. But if you look at it on paper and you don't have any savings to get you started, here's your dilemma. You got to pay the rent right away, but you only have $425 coming in if you don't go into it with anything in reserve. So your first week, your expenses, $800 for rent, $100 for utilities, and $75 for food. I'm not getting into you probably had to make a utility deposit. And this is just a very, very simple make my point. Your first week, your expenses are $975, but you only have $425 coming in. So you're in the hole $550. And so you end the first week, if you did that, you're $550 short. So you don't pay your rent when you're supposed to. And even if you moved into this place, but you're caught up in this cycle, your second month, you're not, let's say you had savings. Well, if you're not on top of your money, you're going to be paying your rent late. You're going to start to have bad credit. You're going to pay utility bill late. You're going to start to have bad credit. So under my example, you get $425 the first week coming in, $425 the second week coming in. And the second week, though, you're going to have $75 more food. And so your only expenses for the second week are just this new, your $350 plus after this, during the second week, but you were $550 down from the first week. So you're $200 in the hole. You still don't have enough money to pay your rent and your utilities in full. So you might pay your utilities, but your rent's not going to get paid till you get your $425 with only $75 for food the next week. What I'm trying to illustrate to you is this. If you're living like this and you're robbing Peter to pay Paul, that's the title of today's show. That means moving it from one place to another using the same funds, going further into debt, but not getting yourself ahead. You've got to have more coming in. And the very best place to have more coming in this type of an example, is to have a savings fund that you can use when you're ready to change something and put your down payment down for that purchase you want to make, instead of taking it out of your current budget, out of your current money coming in. So if you look at this, the example that I'm just giving you, and instead of getting out of your parents' house and burning your bridge and getting into too many arguments with your parents because you just don't want to live under your parents' roof anymore, wait a month. Be nice for a month. Make peace with your parents. Enjoy your mom's food a little while longer. But respect them for the opportunity that they're giving you, because if you have $1,000 savings before you make the commitment to have your own apartment, you start out, instead of being in the hole $550 the first week and catching up slowly but not being able to pay your rent till the third week, you start off with your own money. And when you add the $425 to that, you've got money that week of $1,425, and you only have $975 in expenses, you're $450 to the plus. Your credit is sterling because your landlord knows that you're good to pay on the first of the month. You paid your utility bills. You're developing a habit of doing things on time. So this is the concept. I hope that I haven't gone too far in with numbers, because I have to tell you, when you see it on paper, a week laid out at a time, your ending amount that you're either short or positive to the plus side at the end of the week is your beginning balance in the second week. And then you add everything that's coming in during that week. And then you get a subtotal. You say, this is how much I have. Then you look at all of your obligations and you go, what do I owe this week to keep myself current with everything I'm supposed to do? How much will I have left over after I've done everything I'm supposed to do? And that's when you say, oh, wow, I've got $500 extra this week. But if you don't look at the next week and the next week on paper in front of you, and again, this, you can do it in your mind after you've gotten good at it. You might be in a false sense of security because you see that I've got $500 extra at the end of this week, but you didn't realize that your car insurance payments come up. It's every 6 months, and you got a $450, $600 car insurance premium due that you forgot about. So every now and then, if you take the exercise that Johnnie and I did, and you write down everything that goes out of your life and everything that comes in, and put a date to it and look at it and organize it and see how money is coming in, when it comes in, when money goes out, you won't miss things that catch you off guard by surprise. And anytime you're dealing with your budget and you get caught off guard, it has some very, very negative ramifications. One is, you don't have something that you need it to do. You have to either put it off or disappoint yourself or someone else. It hurts your credit. When you go to get a mortgage or a refinance of something or a car loan, your rate's going to be a lot higher. That's another variable, because if you've got poor credit, they charge you more, or you get turned down. You don't have the freedom to take your kids out and pay for the check that night at that restaurant. And you're living mixed up. You're living to where you're not paying attention. And it's back to that hypothetical 41-2-year-old couple that says, hey, we're on top of it. We're going to keep doing what we're doing. But then some suddenly happens to them that comes up and their refrigerator breaks, and they just didn't have have money to fix it. So they use credit. And then after a while, they forget, you know, it's like you said, when you bring more money in, when you get that raise, I love what you said. What are you using that raise for? Does it just get melted into the rest of your money and you don't see any difference in the way that you're living? That's the problem in life with so many people, is that they think they're ahead of the game and they're not looking down the road. If you do a weekly cash in, cash out budget spreadsheet and see when it happens, it'll make you have better credit and it will identify when you have extra. And after a while, you'll start cutting back on some unnecessary expenses because it's like there's no value in it. Johnnie, that's kind of my presentation on the basics of cash flow, money in and out, cumulative balance carried forward each week, looking at it on paper. What are your thoughts?
You know, I love the concept. And if I may just kind of bring everything that we're talking about kind of together, is the robbing Peter to pay Paul is typically because we don't know what's going on in our budget. So we've talked about accountability, tracking, all of that. It's also about decision-making. Remember, we talked about habits. All of those things will cause us to rob one account for something else, to give it to something else. We talked about decision-making. We talked about going out and eating and doing these things or buying gifts and not considering them in our budget. It's because the next month, either we're deeper in debt, which is a robbing Peter to pay Paul, because debt is actually obligating your future income. That's what debt is obligating your future income, right? So you are, when you have a financial debt on credit cards, it is because you probably didn't have the savings account we talked about. You probably didn't have the emergency fund unless you're paying the bill off every month. So those are the robbing the Peter to pay Paul. And it's to pay Paul is not just for the emergencies that come up, like whether it be the roof or the car or all of those things. The emergency fund becomes, I call it a safety net that when things happen in our lives, and they will happen, that you have this account that you can go to do that. So the whole time we've been together, if we've been talking, even though we didn't say it was robbing Peter to pay Paul, it's been directly related to robbing Peter to pay Paul when you don't have cash flow, when you don't have savings. You have to rob Peter to pay Paul. You have to. And we're trying to eliminate it. It's not that Peter is bad or Paul is bad. That's not the issue. The issue is you having control. So that is the bottom line of this. So we want to position you. We want to guide you. We want to help give you information to ensure that you are the one that's making the decisions in your household as a group. Remember, we talked about that, is as a family, to make those kind of decisions so that you can move forward. And just and remember this for emergency fund, just as a final note, is this. Before you establish an emergency fund, or if you already have one, talk about what's an emergency. Define emergency before you need the money. Define emergency. Because when you have an emergency fund, it can look really sweet. You know, it's like that, you know, the dessert on the side. So you want to be able to define emergency before you need it, especially if you're married or household, so that even though you know you're building it, because it starts looking sweet, oh my gosh, this amount. And so look at it and define the emergency. Emergency is probably not taking a vacation. That's a vacation fund. So just define emergency before you need it, so that it doesn't become an issue in your relationship based on communication. So you decide. You build these habits, you move forward, because you have greatness in you. You have the opportunity to live the best life ever. So it's about the decisions that you make, okay?
That's beautiful. Freedom, July the 4th. But, you know, I think that anybody that's tracking with us, so to speak, this is only our fourth lesson and in this series. And it might be too slow for some people. It might not be as pertinent to you, but that's great if it's slow for you, because that means that you're pretty much there. But just remember, by thinking about this, you might get more fine-tuned. I use the Swiss cheese analogy a lot in life. Swiss cheese is a delicious big block of cheese, but it's riddled with holes. And even those of us that have a lot of really good things going on, a lot of good discipline, there just might be something that you're going to catch on to that Johnnie and I bring up that will help you get to an even higher level. Not sure what that would be, but, and Johnnie and I are not trying to tell you what you should spend your money on. We're just trying to get you to focus it for yourself and make those decisions. It's your choice. That's your freedom. We're not trying to take that away from you. Well, you know, Johnnie, I've enjoyed what we've done today. And I hope that it came across as simple as I wanted it to, as basic without confusing people. But the bottom line is that it's not drudgery to discipline yourself, to look at your finances every now and then. And I had to do it the last couple of weeks. I've had a lot of expenses. I'm in my birthday season right now. I've got about 9 family members whose birthdays were all within a 6-week period. And then we've got anniversaries. Then we had wedding and we had some graduations from college and high school for several different people. And I had a lot of expenses coming at me. And I just had to finally just put it back down on paper. But I don't keep it on paper until I feel a little bit of pressure, when everything's gone good and I got some balances in certain accounts. But I'll say one thing that I did last year, actually 16 months ago, a little over a year, I think it was November of 2019. I put myself on a forced savings program for $500 a month, and it grew really quick. It grew really quick, just like the example in the letter that I gave those high school kids. You know, that the principal alone over 16 months was $8,000. But I hit the markets. The markets went up like 23% to 27% during that time frame for me. So I ended up having $2,700 of earnings on that money that I put aside. That was like, I've never in my life seen money compound that quickly. So my forced savings of $500 each month, even if it hadn't gone up because the markets were so good, and I've never been a person that had money to play the market, so to speak. This was not playing the markets. I just put it into a fixed mutual fund. I never thought about it. I never looked at it. I didn't want to. I just had it taken out of my bank account every month for 16 months now. And I was able to use a little bit of that money because I didn't want to, because I want that savings to keep growing. If I reduce it, it won't grow as quick. But that money came in really, really handy because we had to get a new heating and air system a couple months ago. And the payment's coming up now that I'm making. I didn't have cash for the whole thing. Bottom line, what we're teaching you will help you. And if you want to talk to Johnnie or I, rightthink.org, reach out to us. We promise that we'll respond to you as quick as we can. But I just want to tell you that next week, Johnnie, I've been putting this off. I can't wait. It's my favorite topic, the substitution principle. Next week, we're going to talk about when you get on top of your money, how you start diverting it from one thing that might not have value to another that does, so that you can reach your goals. And so I look forward to sharing that with everyone next week. And Johnnie, I just want to thank you one more time for how much you care about other people. And that I know that what's so good about what you're doing with me is that you're doing this series because you want to give to others. And I thank you. I thank you for where your heart is.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
Well, everyone, enjoy the freedom that we have here. And God bless America. Have a great day.
Thanks for listening to Right Thinking with Steve Coplon. I look forward to being with you again next week. And remember, don't quit. Plan ahead. It will get better. God bless you and have a great week.